Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah amma ba'd. Brothers, I thought inshallah, just give you guys a quick reminder inshallah. Because every night, alhamdulillah, we've been doing this now, and we've been going, and you guys have been reciting the Qur'an in one way or another, okay? Or you've been reading it from the Mus'haf. I've been seeing many of you with my own eyes. Some of you even memorize certain verses, and I see you repeating it, going over. Some of you, I know, still haven't got to that stage, but you still, I see you guys flicking through the little book, The Fortress of a Muslim, and there's even verses of the Qur'an in there, and you're reading them to the best of your ability. And I thought it's important now that I mention to you some of the manners and the etiquettes with regards to the Qur'an. One of the things with regards to the Qur'an is that, brothers, the Qur'an, it has to be implemented. The Qur'an, it has to be implemented. And not implementing the Qur'an, it has consequences. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He described the Jews in the Qur'an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said the example of the Jews, the children of Israel, is what? The example of a donkey. A donkey that's carrying books on its back. This donkey now might have encyclopedias that he's carrying. But will the donkey ever be able to truly understand and implement the knowledge that he's carrying? No. So then Allah's basically telling us, don't be like these donkeys. They read the Qur'an, they have this knowledge, it's with them all day. Some of them memorize these verses, but they're not able to implement them. Their example is the example of a donkey. Another place in the Qur'an, Allah, He talks about a man who was given, knowledge of the revelation, and he decided to not implement it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, his example is the example of a dog. So the people who come to the Qur'an, they come to it, they read it, they know it, they understand it, their verses, they even memorize it, yet they choose to not implement it. Allah describes them as dogs and donkeys. He describes them as dogs and donkeys. Because these people, they have no excuse. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Al-Qur'an hujjatun lak aw alayk. The Qur'an is either going to be a proof for you, or it's going to be a proof against you. This Qur'an is going to come on the Day of Judgment. It's either going to say, Allah, this person recited me and it implemented me, so take him to paradise. Or the Qur'an will say, Allah, this person recited me, read me, even memorized me, came to Medina, came to Mecca, spent time with me, private time with me, and they still went back to their own ways. For this reason, Imam Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says something very powerful. He said, no one comes to the Qur'an and is safe. No one comes to the Qur'an and is safe. Something takes place. Something happens. No one comes to the Qur'an and there's no effect. The effect is one of two. Either the Qur'an, it increases you in mercy, or the Qur'an, it increases you in loss. It either increases you in mercy, because when you read it, you change now. You get a little bit better every time. Every time you come with that little bit extra effort. You're reading these verses about the hellfire. وَيَوْمَ يُعْرَضُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا عَلَى النَّارِ. The day when the disbelievers are presented towards the hellfire, you think, subhanAllah. You hear verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, and on that day they will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you ponder upon it. We're going to stand. The sun is going to be above our heads on the Day of Judgment, drowning in our sweat because of our sins. These verses, they scare you. So you think, let me be better now. But a person who walks away from reading the Qur'an, and it doesn't touch them, just the speech of your Lord, Allah who's above the seven heavens, above His throne, He spoke to you. We're not significant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't need to speak to us. He's got angels that worship Him day in, day out. There are angels, brothers, pay attention. There are angels that from the moment they were created, they've been in prostration in sajda to Allah. They never looked up. And the Day of Judgment, when they look up for the first time, and they look at Allah, for the first time, and they see Allah in all His might and glory, they will say, Allah, we never worshipped You the way You are supposed to be worshipped. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that the heavens, the skies, the samawat, there's no space in them. You won't even find a handspan of space. It doesn't exist. Why? Because there are angels everywhere. They flooded the place with in sajda and ruku', they're worshipping Allah. Allah doesn't need to send down a Quran to you. He doesn't need to send down a speech and a revelation, but He did. Yet He did, out of His love and His mercy. How is that not something that should make you think, right, let me take this serious now. When I read this Qur'an, let me give it some real time. Let me try and ponder on its verses. Let me try and see some way, somehow I can implement these ayat. A person who doesn't have that care, what that person done
is that that person made Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his speech, less significant than a human being. If I as a human being came to you and I spoke to you, look, I'm speaking to you now, and you're paying attention, right? So you pay attention to what I'm saying, you ponder what I'm telling you. Or another human being tells you. A human being might not even tell you about anything serious, might just be telling you jokes and little stories, and sometimes even be telling you haram. But you pay attention to that, and you're focused on that. And you want to understand what he says. Sometimes they give you advice, which you want to implement. And that's a human. A human who really is not really that important. He craps the same way as you, and he goes and urinates in a toilet the same way as you. There's nothing special or important about him. Yet you give more weight and value to his speech and not Allah's. This person now is really, he's really saying, Allah, you know, increase me in loss. Because I've taken you, the King of Kings, and I've made you lower than a human being. Does that make sense? So for that reason, brothers, don't forget that there are two types of tilawa. Tilawa means recitation. Recitation. There are two types of recitation. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابِ يَتْلُونَهُ حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِهِ. The ones who they were given the book and they recite it the way it deserves to be recited. They recite it the way it deserves to be recited. And then Allah said, وَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِهِ. But there are those, they disbelieve in it. They disbelieve in the recitation of the Quran. فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. They are the ones who are going to be in loss. They are the ones who are going to be destroyed. What is this recitation that Allah is talking about here? Look, pay attention. Allah said those who recite the Quran the way it deserves to be recited, they are the ones who truly believe in it. I mean, they are real believers. The way they recite it. What does that mean? And those, they don't recite properly, they are disbelievers now. They're kuffar. What does this mean? Imam Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he told us in a nutshell, he said, this means that you recite the Quran through your body. He didn't say it in these words, but I'm just trying to summarize his speech to you. Basically, you recite the Quran through your body, not just your tongue. The tongue, anyone can do. The tongue, I can go onto Instagram right now and I can pull out half a dozen reciters with a banging voice who recite the Quran beautifully. And then they go hang around with girls and put music on in their Snapchat videos. That's easy. We can find that for days. But reciting the Quran beautifully, I even found a Chinese person doing it once. It's not really a big thing. Anyone with a nice voice, learns the rules of tajweed, they can do that. But the Quranic recital that Allah is concerned with is when your body recites the Quran. And how does your body recite the Quran? By action. By implementing it. By implementing these verses and these ayat. If you do that, the way you do that is whenever Allah made haram, you make it haram. You don't come out with music is not haram. Women don't have to wear hijab. I don't have to lower my gaze. You don't come with that kalam. Whatever Allah made haram, you make it haram. Whatever Allah made halal, you make it halal. The way that the Sahaba believed, you believe in that way. You do what this Quran tells you to do. When you do that, brothers, you will only be increased in mercy. And the Quran will come to you, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it will come to you on the Day of Judgment as an intercessor. The Quran will come to help you on that day. And that's a dark day, brothers. Pay attention, that's a very dark day. A day when your own mom will leave you. يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ. Allah said, on that day, a man will run from his brother. وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ. A mother and father will run away. They'll run away. A child will run from his own mom and dad. وَصَاحِبَتِهِ. A man will run away from his own wife. He doesn't feel safe with his wife. Your wife is the only one that you can feel so safe and comfortable with, you can be naked in front of her. That's how safe you feel with this woman. But on that day, you're not safe. She wants something from you. She wants revenge. On that day, everyone's counting their deeds. And they're like, I'm a bit short today. But I remember, my husband, on this day, he spoke to me a certain kind of way. Today, I'm going to get justice. And on that day, the way that people take revenge is by taking your good deeds or giving you their sins. So you're running from your mom, you're running from your dad, your sister, your wife, Wabani, your own child, you run from them. On that day, no one cares about anyone. But like in the Prophet said, the Quran will come. The Quran will come to you on that day. The Prophet describes some surah, Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-Imran. It will come in the form of a canopy. Why canopy? Because a canopy, what? It brings about shade. A canopy brings shade. On that day, it's dark. The sun is above you, people are drowning. The Quran will come to give you shade. It will come like birds chirping. because birds, they, you know, come chirping. The Prophet is describing it in a nice, beautiful way. These surahs, these chapters will come like birds chirping. Like in the morning, you know, it's darkness, right? At night time, suddenly you know the morning's about to come. Even though it's dark, you hear the birds starting to chirp. You know the light's about to shine through. So it comes to you in this way. And it comes and it says to Allah, Allah, this person, he lived by me. He lived by me. So through this, give this person paradise. Does that make sense? The reason I'm saying this, brothers, is because we don't just go, recite, and come back the exact same way. Every day, hold yourself to account. How can I do better? How can I do better? Does that make sense? Even if you don't read a lot of the Quran, if you don't understand much of the Quran, at night time when you read, during the day, try and work out the translation. What was it that I was reading? Maybe, you know, sometimes you'll be reading a certain ayah, a certain surah, and you think, right, it touched me. I don't even know why it touched me. It just sounded like it. Go to someone. We've got so many brothers here. We've got Brother Adam here. We've got Ustad Abu Taymiyyah, Ustad Yes. We've got so many people around us. Say, what's the tafsir of this? What does this ayah mean? Explain it to me. You should be eager to know what is the meaning of these verses. Does that make sense? If you do that, brothers, that is what will increase you. That is what will change you. The Quran is what changes people. The Sahaba were murderers. Pay attention. Sahaba were murderers. Sahaba, you know the kind of things they used to do? We think we're bad. Do you think we have problems? The Sahaba were so bad. They used to have a gambling problem before Islam. They used to have a gambling problem. People, you think it's bad, a guy goes to the bookies and he spends all his money. These men would gamble their wives. They would come out, they would gamble, they would bring his wives and his daughters and say, let's gamble. And you might end up winning a man's wife, or he might lose his daughter to you. And then because of that, right, he's going to take my daughter now. Then they start war, fighting, killing. These people would fight and kill each other over camels. Some companions buried their daughters alive. That's not normal murder. It's murder as bad as it is. But these guys are killing their own children. What changed their hearts? What penetrated their hearts? Brothers, it's the Quran that changed it. Something about this book, it entered these people. And they thought, oh, I have to change now. These were people that what they would do, a woman would sleep with so many men, suddenly she would get pregnant. She would literally spin a bottle, whichever man it landed on, say, that's the husband now. You're the father of the child. A man will have a guest that will come to his house. And you know when a guest comes, you treat him right, right? Give him food, drink, water. They would give their wives for the night. So this is how our hospitality, this is the kind of people that they were. They were filthy, man. Wallahi, they were not as bad as you think you might be. You were not as bad as these people. But those people became Umar ibn Khattab. Those people became Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, Zubayr ibn Awwam. These great giants who today, we know they're in paradise, inshallah. We know Allah told us they're going to be in Jannah. The Quran, they took it, they heard it. Oh, it done something to them. These words, powerful, the meanings, and they were strong. Suddenly, next thing you know, they started to implement. They started to understand there was a day that's going to come. You're going to stand before your Lord. And everything you've done is going to be brought before you. And before that day comes anyway, there's going to be a day when you stand in your grave. The angels are going to come. They're going to speak to you. They're going to converse with you. They're going to ask you what time of the week it was. What were you really on? And that is really where it starts. And that day is not far. How many people that we know, their day of judgment has already started? They're dead. Put your hand up if you know someone who's died. Put your hand up if you know someone who died and they're younger than 30. Keep your hand up. There you go, their day of judgment already started. May Allah have mercy on them and forgive them and enter them into paradise, ameen. But that day is not far. That day is round the corner, does that make sense? But this Quran, it does something. And I'm going to leave you on one statement. And the statement's a bit dark. It's not the most happiest kind of statement. Like, I know a lot of the reminders I've been given are a little bit grim and a bit dark and whatever have you. But I like to start off just giving it to you how it is. And when we go to Mecca, like I said, we could talk about the women in Jannah and we could talk about all those nice, lovely things, inshallah. But right now, I have to give it to you a bit raw. So I want to make sure I give you a statement that really, if you listen to me, brothers, with an open ear and a sincere heart, this statement, it will concern you tonight. It really will. When you go to the masjid, you won't be able to focus properly on anything except for worshipping Allah. The statement is a statement by Imam Ibn Qayyim. He said that either you are going to be affected by the Quran, your heart is going to be affected by the Quran, and it will bring tears to your eyes in this life, or your heart will be affected when Allah brings the hellfire in front of you on the day of judgment, and then you will cry. Does that make sense? It's better you take it from the Quran today so that you don't have to take it from the hellfire on the day of judgment. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Assalamu alaykum. Brothers and sisters, as you guys may be aware, we do
Umrah trips where we take brothers and we also take sisters, those who are not practicing, those who are on the streets, those who are on the verge of losing their iman, some of them, and we take them on this Umrah trip, and it functions as a spiritual rehabilitation and reformation for them. We're taking people that have spent over 10 years in jail. We're taking people who were involved in drug, usage of drugs, selling drugs, criminal activity. But alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, these people, they change now. They change it and they do a 180. And not only that, some of them went on to study their religion, seek knowledge. And some of them are now starting to work towards, you know, after a while, starting to become positive figures in their community and getting other people off the streets and getting involved in deed and knowledge and da'wah. But they can't afford it because either their money is haram or they're just broke. They don't have the money, but they need this trip for their iman. Listen, it could be that these people, if you help send them, you help change their life, then you get the reward of sending them to Umrah and even the good that they do after, inshallah ta'ala. So if you could please donate at the link below generously so people like that can have an opportunity to change their life and have a second chance at life, inshallah ta'ala, we'll be truly grateful. I know they definitely would. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, will reward you in abundance. So please, if you want to come, ring the number below, inshallah ta'ala. And if you'd like to donate, hit the link below, inshallah ta'ala. Barakallahu feek. Salaamu alaikum.